How's it going?
This is 49ers Talk, brought to you by Big O Tires.
That is the truth. What yes. I miss.
And did you know, Laura, that you know that we're recording, right?
Yeah. Well, so the announcement was made.
We didn't even have to hear this.
This meeting is being recorded.
We didn't even have to do that.
Well, I did hear it. I did just hear it.
Yeah, but that was in reference to the last episode of 49ers Talk. When apparently we didn't have a whole lot to talk about, and that announcement also caught us by surprise. But now we have something to talk about, because who showed up at 49ers OTAs? Well, almost everybody on the team, and also everybody on our little team here of 49ers Talk. Laura, it's good to see you out there in Santa Clara.
Yeah, it was so fun. I loved being out there. It was funny. The PR team was like, what are you doing here? So it was good to get back out there. And a lot of the questions, we got to speak to some of the players after OTAs on Tuesday, and a lot of the players were just talking about normalcy and getting back to normalcy and how nice it was. And that was so refreshing for us too.
And it was the interesting thing, as we all remember, back in April, the NFLPA, the players union, sent out statements for a lot of teams, including the 49ers. And the statement was, you know, due to the COVID protocols and just where the NFL is with the NFLPA, there seemed to be a little bit of acrimony or both sides not on the same page. The NFLPA sent out a statement from, quote, the 49ers players that said many in our locker room would not be present for at least a portion of the offseason program. Well, based on what we saw Tuesday in Santa Clara, that could not be further from the truth. The only player that I could detail who wasn't there, who hasn't been there, is Robbie Gould, the kicker. And I'm not sure he's ever taking part in that. And you know, he has a family back in Chicago. There's really no reason for him to be there. So that's fine. But, I mean, everybody else has been there. The exceptions on this week, Nick Bosa, but he's been... He came to Santa Clara in February, met with the medical staff, met with Kyle Shanahan, and they all decided, hey, keep doing your thing. You know, we see the videos of you working out in Fort Lauderdale with your guy there and with your brother and everything else. So, you know, why travel cross country and go through a different routine? Keep doing what you're doing. And then Dee Ford, who has been around for almost the entire offseason, they said, hey, just go home, chill a little bit, keep rehabbing, and then come back out here and we'll see what you can do. But I think it's very encouraging, especially this season of all seasons, that it's darn near 100% participation for the 49ers in their offseason program.
Yeah, there were so many players out on the field. It was hard to keep track of everybody because we're not used to seeing quite that many guys out there. It was a lot, a sea of numbers out on the practice field.
Can I ask you a question, Laura?
Yeah.
Did you think I was being antisocial?
You were being a little antisocial, but here's a little behind the scenes. It's hard to be social. There's a balance when you're, you know, obviously we're all working when we're out there, and there's so much going on that you really have to focus. We've got our rosters out. You're trying to watch. Most people have not gotten the opportunity, I'm sure, to see an OTA practice. So what happens is the players are all on separate fields working out with their different position groups, and then they'll all come together depending on the period and do different drills together and do some 11-on-11 and different things like that. But it's hard because you've got to really decide what you want to focus in on. Do I want to watch the quarterbacks, and how long do I want to watch them? Do I want to watch the running back group? Do I want to watch the defensive players? You know, that's what's hard. So, you know, we haven't seen our colleagues in a long time, so we're all trying to catch up and say hi, but you're also keeping, you know, an eye on the field, trying to keep up with everything that's going on. So I was not offended by your non-social tactic. I expected it because you're out there working. You're giving the people what they want, Matt.
And I do believe that you did ask me earlier in the week. You said, are you going to be taking a roll call? And sure enough, I did. 90 players out there. And so I'm like going through the numbers. And I think there are 3 number 7s on the team.
There are. Yeah. Wait, hold on. So how, I need details. Do you highlight once you see a guy? How do you keep up with it?
You know what I do is I put a little, just a little line through the number so I can still see what the number is on my roster. Okay. And I do the numerical order. And usually I do like offensive and defensive linemen first and then work over to the quarterbacks, running backs, wide receivers.
So you've got a process.
I got a process. And then what I do is I go through and I look at, oh, who didn't I check off yet? And then I specifically look for that position group and try to find him. And that's the way I was with Jeff Wilson, because I'm looking at the running backs. I was like, oh, the one running back I haven't seen is Jeff Wilson. And then I remember thinking about social media that the 49ers had posted. And I remember Jeff Wilson being, you know, at the 49ers facility. And so it wasn't until after the fact, and the 49ers didn't mention this to us, that Jeff Wilson had like this really bad injury, and it was the craziest injury. And this occurred last Thursday, where he went to lift in the 49ers weight room. He does the legs. It's leg day, apparently, on Thursday. And he came into the locker room, and he was chatting with some of his teammates. He was sitting down. He got up and kind of whatever, like, I guess, kind of awkwardly turned to talk to somebody else. And his knee gave out on him. And it locked up. And he's like, what's going on here? He went in for an MRI the next day. And his meniscus was totally shot. And so he had to have surgery Friday. And this wasn't one of those, I don't know if you've ever had a meniscus injury. It's the cartilage in the knee. Sometimes you just kind of clip, you know, it kind of fragments or whatever. You kind of clip it off and you go on, you know, you're out for a couple weeks or whatever. But this was full on bad, bad tear. And so he's going to be out 4 to 6 months.
Yeah. And I know, such a freak injury.
Yeah. And so bad for him, because, you know, this is his contract year. He signed a nice deal, nice 1 year deal with the 49ers, but he's going to be out. And John Lynch said on Wednesday that more than likely he'll start the season on the physically unable to perform list, which means he'd be out for 6 weeks to start the year.
Yep.
And we already know that the 49ers have good depth there. So, you know, they can withstand an injury or two, and now they currently have 5 running backs, and they're all good players. You know, we're talking about Raheem Mostert, Wayne Gallman, Jamichael Hasty, and then the 2 rookies, Trey Sermon and Elijah Mitchell. So they're covered at that position. And so kind of the silver lining in this is that Jeff Wilson's attacking his rehab. He's going to do all the right things. We know Jeff. He's a good guy. He's worked for everything he's gotten in this league. And so when he comes back, when he's cleared to play sometime, maybe in the middle of the season, you know, the good news is he'll be fresh. And I think, I mean, they'll need him at some point, you know, regardless of how well everybody else is playing. Jeff Wilson's going to see some football for this team. So it was a tough blow and just a weird injury. But the good news is it seems like he has a good mindset about it. And yes, he's devastated. He was initially devastated that this injury occurred. But he still should be able to make an impact on this team. So that was one of the big nuggets. Yeah, one of the surprises. Yeah. And I always say, like in this time of year, whenever there's news, it's generally bad news for the team.
Yeah.
And this is definitely one of those instances where Jeff Wilson is a guy that, you know, is that going to be out of the picture here for a while.
Yeah, and I think he'll also see playing time, because since this injury, this kind of ties in, I believe it was our last episode, maybe 2 episodes ago, where we were talking about if a player is injured at the facility while working out with the team, you know, he does get his money still. So that is the situation that Jeff Wilson Jr. falls into. So he will still get paid. So I imagine that the 49ers will also want to see some value when he's able to come back. And obviously they're most concerned right now with his health and his rehab, but when he is able to get back on the field, he was the team's leading rusher last season. So you're going to want Jeff Wilson Jr. back out on the field.
Yeah, and it's interesting that you say that, Laura, because that was my first question. That, you know, I was like, gosh, is this some kind of cover-up going on here that the 49ers didn't, you know, divulge that Wilson was injured last week. But my first thought was, boy, I wonder if this happened at the facility or if it happened away from the facility, you know, if it happened before he reported to camp and or to the 49ers, and would this perhaps cause an issue as far as that goes. But no, the 49ers said, John Lynch said, you know, we got his back. We're going to get through this and we're going to support him. And so his money was guaranteed. And because he was injured on the grounds there in Santa Clara, you know, there's no question what his future is. So that's one thing that we learned about. And just to kind of hit on some of the other injury related stuff for the 49ers, Nick Bosa is not in Santa Clara. He's working out in Florida, as I mentioned, and he's on track to report to the 49ers and be there for training camp. Now, he'll report before that, but he's not going to do any practicing during these OTAs and during the offseason. And the same can be said for Jalen Hurd. And in fact, I think, Laura, you and I, about the only time I talked to you, I pointed across the field and I said, there's Jalen Hurd working out.
Yeah, well, I apparently need to learn from you because you're smart and you brought binoculars. We are so far away from the players that it's actually hard to see what's going on. And of course, they keep the quarterbacks kind of far away from us on the other end of the field. So Matt's smart. He's the vet. I'm the not even rookie, but acting like a rookie over here without bringing some binoculars. So I've got to invest in that. I'm going to make that investment before I see the players again, so that you can really get a sense, because I'm over there with my papers on my head, squinting, trying to see what's going on the other side of the field. So I was really thankful that you brought that to my attention. And then I focused on Jalen Hurd for a little bit, because that's really one of the big questions we've been getting all off season. What's the deal with Jalen Hurd? I mean, even up to the last time we asked for Twitter questions, people were asking for an update on Jalen Hurd, and rightfully so. I mean, he is a really talented player with a lot of promise. So Niners fans just want to see him out on the field, and not just Niners fans. I mean, the coaching staff wants to see what he's capable of on the field too. And I'm sure the quarterbacks as well.
And so one of the good things about me pointing to Jalen Hurd across the field is that he is so big, you don't need binoculars to see him.
Yeah, you really don't. But all the guys are so big that, you know, it's not like when you see Jalen Hurd out in the street or, you know, at a restaurant, it's Jalen Hurd next to, you know, Mike McGlinchey. And right, so then all of a sudden he doesn't look that big anymore.
Yeah. In this case, he was next to Dustin Little, who's the 49ers head athletic trainer. And so, you know, they're getting him into shape, and 49ers really hope that this is a year that Jalen Hurd's able to get out there and make an impact. Another guy, two guys we did not see out there, D Ford. Yeah. And so, as I mentioned, Kyle Shanahan and the 49ers sent him home, back to his hometown. He's going to see a doctor there. And the 49ers are, I would guess, it's cautiously optimistic that he'll be able to show up at training camp and do something. But, you know, we've talked about this, Laura, pretty much since both of these guys, D Ford and Weston Richburg, were injured and, you know, they weren't going to make an impact last season. Is that you just, I don't think you can really bank on either one of those guys playing. And for D Ford, you know, even if he's able to get back to that point where the back is feeling well enough that he's going to give it a shot, we just don't know how productive he's going to be or even how long he's going to be out there. So we'll see with D Ford. You know, they've tried to cover their backsides by bringing in.
You're so politically correct today.
Backside, because I usually just throw out all the four letter words. Is that what you're saying?
No, not at all.
Or in this case,
the word
I'm thinking about.
PG.
Yeah,
PG.
I was thinking about wasn't a four letter word. It was a three letter word, by the way. But anyway,
exactly.
Yes.
And nonetheless, so, we get the picture.
Yes. So we'll see with D Ford. And then, like we talked about, Weston Richburg is in fact going to retire, which is no big surprise. Yeah. And man, you know, I feel so bad for him. I hope he's able to, you know, to be pain-free and live a life that he can do a lot of things. But man, just football wasn't in the cards for him. As far as once he signed the big money deal with the 49ers, he came here injured year one, was playing some really outstanding football in 2019 before he sustained the injury, the knee injury. And then last year had all kinds of issues with the knee, with shoulder. And so, you know, his career is over, unfortunately, just because, you know, the body gave out on him and he just had some unfortunate injuries. So really sad to see Weston Richburg when he was playing good in 2019. I mean, he very well could have been a Pro Bowl type of player.
Yeah, for as excited as we get to see players on draft day get drafted and all the hoopla and excitement that's surrounded by that, you hate to see these moments where it doesn't work out for some guys because of injuries. And we've talked about this so much, and even Jimmy Garoppolo was asked about this when we were able to speak to him, too.
Who's that? Who?
Jimmy Garoppolo, a Garoppolo quarterback. He's a quarterback on the roster for the 49ers.
Okay, yeah, I think I've heard of him.
Yeah, Jimmy G, some people refer to him as. You might know him by that nickname. Uh-huh. He was asked about this, too, just with injuries. It's not necessarily your fault.
Yeah.
It's bad luck sometimes. It's not necessarily your fault. But I did find it interesting, switching gears to Jimmy G, that he did talk about bulking up. That's been, you know, there were a lot of pictures floating around and people were wondering, did he get, you know, a little bit stockier, bulk up a little bit? And he did say that he tried to this offseason.
Well, he did say that he didn't gain weight. He's still around, I think he's around 225, but he redistributed his weight, something that I know a lot about. I've redistributed my weight multiple times through the course of my career.
Just transfer it.
Yes, and it's not always a good thing. It's not always at all appealing, but that is the case. And you know what? Let's talk a little bit more about Jimmy G and that young quarterback with the 49ers right after this word from Big O Tires.
It's the Memorial Day sale at Big O Tires. Get up to $250 in savings. Save $100 instantly on select tires and get a free basic alignment. Spend $500 or more using your Big O credit card and get a $50 mail-in rebate only at Big O Tires.
All right, we're back on 49ers talking. We were just talking about Jimmy Garoppolo, and we haven't talked about Trey Lance, but we certainly will talk about Trey Lance. The first thing, and it kind of picks up on what you were talking about before the break, Laura, is just Garoppolo and his approach. You know, and he's been through a tumultuous offseason. Well, heck, he's been through a tumultuous year with the injuries last year, the two high ankle sprains, and missing 10 games, and then getting the word on March 26th that basically his time with the 49ers is soon coming to an end. So here's a question that I asked Jimmy about, you know, what his focus was this offseason and how he tried to deal with that, I mean, for lack of a better word, you know, disappointment that the 49ers were going to be moving on from him at some point and drafting a quarterback number three. So here's what Jimmy Garoppolo had to say.
You know, I just focus on the same things I always have, really. I mean, it's the offseason is a time for me to grow, for our team to grow, and just you try to improve on the things that you didn't do so well the year before. So, I mean, this offseason I had a list of things that I wanted to improve on. First of all, get the body back right, healthy and everything, and that it's been going really well. Body feels great. And just, you know, there's some little things throughout the offense that we've been trying to work on, and I've been trying to critique myself as hard as I can, you know, just fix the little things.
You know, Matt, just listening to everything that he had to say, I've been really impressed with how he's handled himself. It shouldn't come as a surprise to anybody. We've heard that from John Lynch and Kyle Shanahan, his teammates, George Kittle, obviously his good friend. I'm just consistently impressed. He talked a lot about just being himself. Mm-hmm. He's not trying to force any kind of awkward relationship with Trey Lance. He mentioned multiple times that Trey Lance is a cool dude, but it's not like they're texting each other 100 times a day. He's letting that relationship evolve. And he even said that will come in its due time. It's not, he's not trying to be forceful with anything. He's not trying to be awkward about anything. He said the quarterback room is really close. They're a close-knit group, and that the entire room is good. And he kind of kept talking about the entire quarterback room whenever he was asked about Trey Lance. And I just really appreciate it. I appreciate his honesty, and I feel like he is staying true to himself. He's not trying to be anything that he's not, or overcompensate to welcome Trey Lance, or undercompensate and be mean to the guy. He's not doing any of those things. He just is.
That's funny, because I remember specifically, and I'm not going to mention the two quarterbacks that I was covering back in the day, but I remember one quarterback was coming in from the organization who had previous experience with the other, with the offensive coordinator who was coming in. And that quarterback wasn't real helpful to the incumbent quarterback who I had a, you know, a better relationship with, had known for a while. And he was like, yeah, I just don't get it. He won't even give me the answers. Like, I'll ask him, like, you know, when this happens, what does this mean? Or how am I supposed to react to that? And I guess, you know, this quarterback would kind of look at him and go, you got to figure that out on your own, pal. And so
That's not what's happening.
In fact, let's play what Jimmy said about Trey Lance being one cool dude.
You know, me and Trey's real cool. We've had a great relationship so far. All the QBs. I mean, we've got a big QB room right now. So it's a good group of guys. Fun to be around. But, you know, it's kind of one of those things. I don't want to do anything out of the ordinary, do something that's not me. So I just, you know, I try to treat it just like I normally would with anyone else. So just go about my business, just be myself, and, you know, let the cards fall as they may, or chips fall as they may.
Hey. Cards, chips, whatever. We know what Jimmy Garoppolo meant about the cards falling where they may, or the chips falling where they may. But
he fits in right here on 49ers Talk. We can't find the right words half the time.
Yes. Yeah. But like, he's a quarterback. He can get away with that. We're sure. Yeah. Okay. So anyway,
minor details, Maiocco, minor details.
Well, let me throw a spiral your way here, Laura, because let's step outside of our comfort zone. You were out there at practice. I'll give you my thoughts. There wasn't a whole lot really to see because there were only two periods of it, or no, there was only one period of 11-on-11. And I think Jimmy took about four snaps. Trey Lance took, I think, four or five snaps. And then Josh Rosen, Josh Johnson, and Nate Sudfeld, we didn't see them at all in 11-on-11. So were there any things that kind of stood out to you just briefly watching Jimmy Garoppolo and Trey Lance taking snaps and throwing the ball around?
This is going to be a bombshell for everyone. Deebo Samuel and Brandon Ayuk are still really, really good. I saw Jimmy Garoppolo make a couple completions to both of those guys. I saw Trey Lance make a couple of completions to both of those guys. And I saw Trey Lance, and I can't remember if it was to Ayuk or Samuel. Maybe you can help me out here. He did like a one-legged throw. Mm-hmm. Was it Ayuk or Deebo that had that great catch? He was under some pressure. Trey Lance had a great, you know, escaped the pocket, one-legged throw, a great catch by Samuel or Ayuk. And it was kind of a little flash of what you can hope to see in the fall.
That's kind of funny because I noticed that too. It was like, hold it, you know, like there were four completions during 11-on-11. Two went to Samuel, two went to Ayuk, and one from each of the quarterbacks. And so it's like, okay, well, Trey Lance has figured it out. You know, he knows who the top two receivers are. And that doesn't help the 49ers because they know who the top two receivers are. I saw the first time on the practice field, I've seen Travis Benjamin. And he's fast, you know.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like in 7-on-7, he looked good. But I would say, man, Jimmy Garoppolo, I thought he looked really good, you know, and he does look good on the practice field. And I know my wife will say, well, of course he looks good. But I mean, like as a football player.
Your wife and George Kittle.
And George Kittle, yeah. George is always talking about his chin line. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess there's something to that.
I
guess he's got a good chin line. I don't really know. I don't focus on chin lines that much, I don't think.
Yeah, I was focusing on how he was throwing the football, and I thought he looked really good. But I've never thought he didn't look good. You know, he's a good quarterback, and you and I have talked about this for 3 years or more, that Jimmy Garoppolo is a good quarterback. He just needs to stay on the field. And, you know, he talked about that's his focus, staying on the field. And you always kind of wonder, you know, how much of it is just dumb luck, how much of it is trying to get your body right. And he talked about hydrating and just taking care of his body and flexibility and all this stuff and redistributing weight. But I just think that, like you've said, Laura, and I'm going to pat you on the back, it's going to be really difficult, I think, for Trey Lance to get his game up to the point where he is somebody who can take over for Jimmy Garoppolo and make the 49ers a better team, at least here initially in 2021.
Oh, were we recording on that?
Do you want me to do the thing where we stop recording?
I wanted to make sure we were recording that piece where you said that you were going to pat me on the back.
Are you going
to
like?
Can we replay that a few times, just like back to back to back? That'd be great. No, I'm with you on that. It's Jimmy Garoppolo is so calm, cool, and collected, and you do get a feel, and this is what we've been missing, not being able to be around the team. I did get the sense that it is still Jimmy Garoppolo's team. Like, he very much, not in like a, I'm throwing my shoulders back, I own this practice field, but it's Jimmy G's team. It felt that way out there. But Trey Lance was very much a part of OTAs, was very much involved, had some great completions, was really impressive. And also, you know, George Kittle had high praise for Trey Lance. Other teammates had high praise for Trey Lance, including Kyle Shanahan, who was obviously asked about him. Let's listen to what Shanahan had to say after Tuesday's OTAs.
Yeah, I mean, as a person, definitely. I mean, the player, you know, the ability that he has, you can see that on tape. You don't really come and look at it as, you know, from a coaching standpoint, like each day, like, how'd he do today? Is he that good? Is he not? It's you want to get to know the guy. I got an idea of who I think the person is, and being with him these last 2 weeks, he's been everything that we hoped and more. I think he's a very smart kid. He's a very humble kid. I think he's a very natural leader. I think the guys have gravitated to him, and it's been fun to throw a lot at him. You know, you do it for 2 days in rookie mini camp, and to watch him just take it all in. I mean, from how he calls a play in the huddle, to how he takes a snap under center, to how he stands in shotgun, to how he does everything, it's new. We're asking him to do something different, and to just absorb all that in, and to still handle yourself the right way, to me that is impressive, and that's what I've expected from him, and haven't been disappointed in that. And that's why I'm thankful to get OTAs and stuff, because that's why OTAs, I try not to judge too much with anybody. You throw so much at people, and it's so how much can they soak in? And they go through a lot of highs and lows in those 9 practices, and then they get away for 40 days. They kind of get to figure out what they just went through, how to do it on their own, and then they come back to training camp and you see what you really got.
Yeah, so Kyle Shanahan talking about how fun it is to throw stuff at Trey Lance and see how much he's able to absorb. And so I think the 49ers are in a good spot. And, you know, the thing you said before Kyle spoke there, Laura, was, you know, how Jimmy's handling this. And I think, man, when you handle it with kind of the, what's the word? I mean, the professionalism.
Poise, I think.
The grace.
Grace, I think.
And I'd say even kindness. When he was talking about why he texted Trey Lance after the draft pick was made, he said because he realizes how cool it is to get drafted. No matter where you're getting drafted, you're only going to get drafted into the NFL once. And so he wanted to send him a note saying, congratulations. Like, you worked hard to get to this point. And hey, enjoy it, and can't wait to meet you. And so I think that's the kind of thing, you know, so much of this, there's so many layers to this, because he admitted, or kind of admitted, that when he was first told about the trade, that so many different things were going through his mind. He said a million things.
Yeah, he admitted that.
And he intimated that he even probably briefly thought, the heck with it. Just trade me. If you don't want me, trade me. And then the more he
which is normal.
Completely understandable. And then it kind of marinated a little bit more, and he's like, no, you know what? I want to go compete. You know, I want to win football games. And he goes, that's what I do. I win football games. And that's what he has done with the 49ers. He's won a lot of football games. So I just think that the way he's handled it almost makes him more of a leader than if he had kind of bristled up and was like, I'm not going to help the rookie. I'm going to give him the cold shoulder. I'm going to try to divide this locker room. I mean, everybody on this team has reason to support Jimmy. And also everybody on this team has every reason in the world to fall in line behind Jimmy and support Trey Lance. So I think the way he's handled it, and just the, you know, the vibe that he gave off when we spoke to him on Tuesday, the vibe he gave off on the practice field, very commendable, and hats off to Jimmy Garoppolo.
Yeah, I think the biggest statement that he made that really, I think, is a good summary of what he had to say when he was talking to us on Tuesday is, the situation is what it is, and it's not changing. He went on to say, I just try to put my best foot forward. I think he is a bigger picture guy. after he got over that initial shock and he said he had to process everything, and once he did, he realized, I just got to go out there and play ball. I just got to go out there and play ball. And now that he's there, and I think he's been there for a while now in this mindset, he realizes the bigger picture, and he can't change anything about the situation, so he's going to make the best of it. And I was impressed with that. And I was, you know, George Kittle was also asked about Trey Lance, and he had great things to say about Trey Lance, as well as his pal Jimmy Garoppolo. He continues to say he's out there slinging the ball, you know, doing all that, talking about his chin line that he's obsessed with. But it's, and if you look on the 49ers social media, you can see that, like, the lovability, that's a new word, I guess, between Jimmy and George is still there. You know, they were walking out on the practice field, the social media team catches them, and in their truest sense, they're just happy to be out there playing football. And that's what I really got the sense of that overall with how many guys showed up. George Kittle weighed in on that. He said, I think it shows that we all just want to be here and we want to learn. And he also spoke to the effect of how important OTAs are. For not just the players, for the coaches too, that they're all able to be out there together and get those little nuggets from the coaches that they didn't get last season.
Yeah, I like the thing I like about George. I remember asking him, I forget if his first year or second, it must have been his second year in the league. Maybe it was his third. Yeah, it would have been his second year about, you know, CJ Beathard was his college teammate. And then Nick Mullins took over for CJ. And, you know, George is raving about the way Nick Mullins was playing at the end of that 2018 season. And I was like, does it make any, you know, any awkwardness, or, you know, CJ's your guy, you've known him for 5 or 6 years, and now Mullins coming in, and George is like, no, CJ's my guy, but Nick Mullins is my guy too. You know, I can have more than one guy. So, you know, it's a good approach to take. I have one thing. Did Jimmy say it is what it is, or did you paraphrase him saying it is what it is?
No, he said the situation is what it is and it's not changing.
Okay. What do you think of that cliche, it is what it is?
I think...
Have you ever thought about it? Like,
I think the cliche is what it is.
Oh, you know what? That's probably a good time for me to play this.
The recording has stopped.
The recording has stopped, Laura. I'll see you this weekend on 40.
We're out.